Welcome. Many thanks for joining us here for this GTV special program coming to you from the office of the president. And this program is being aired on GTV as well as on all our other TV channels and 15 radio stations spread across the length and breadth of the country. This is in collaboration with the Daily Graphic, and we are privileged to be coming your way from the office of the president. My name is Abdul Hayy Mumin, and I'll be doing this with the political news editor at the Daily Graphic, Obiasma, right here. Thank you very much. And we are privileged to have with us none other than the president of the Republic of Ghana. And you recall that on the 7th of January this year, 2017, Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo was sworn in as president of the Republic. Since then, he has begun the business of governing our nation. He has put together a list of ministers which has generated some amount of debate within the public space out there. And we are here to find out from him. Already, his finance minister has also read the budget for the year 2017, and he himself has presented the state of the nation address to all of us. Going forward, what are some of the key areas that President Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo intends to concentrate on? These and many more are some of the issues we intend to ask him about. And I'll give the first privilege to my senior colleague here. And so please, you take over and then we'll come in.
Well, out in the public domain is this brouhaha where the appointment of your ministers is creating a lot of mixed interpretations. Would you please take this opportunity to explain to us what accounts for this high numbers of ministerial appointments?
First of all, let me thank you. I think the two of you are the first people to come here to interview me ever since I came to this room and to this office. So I have to thank you very much for taking the trouble to come and meet with me. I don't believe that any government in the Fourth Republic has inherited the challenges that my government has inherited. We're talking about a country with a 74% GDP to debt ratio, 2.4 billion debt overhang in the energy sector, persistent decline in industrial and agricultural output, production, the slowest rate of growth over the last 20 years, 3.6% rate of growth, widespread unemployment, major issues of corruption, and the leakage, persistent leakage of revenues from our system. This is the background to my coming into office. And it is the reason also why I'm in office, because these were the circumstances facing the people of Ghana that persuaded them that they needed a new change in direction and a new change in national leadership. Further, in order to address these challenges, I believe I have put before the people of Ghana, I did so in the election, and I've certainly done so in my State of the Nation address, as well as in the budget that the Finance Minister Ofori-Atta put before the Parliament of Ghana, by the way, a budget that is now being passed. We put before the Ghanaian people the most ambitious program of social and economic transformation, I believe, in the history of the Fourth Republic, with all sorts of new and dedicated initiatives. Again, the parliamentary majority that the MPP has brought a whole host of really excellent material into the public space of our country. When you put all of these circumstances together, my assessment was that we needed to really put all hands on deck and needed the cooperation of the material in my party, in the country, that would allow me to deal with these issues. And already I think that the signs are there that this government, despite the inheritance, despite these huge challenges that are facing us, has begun to put its hand and began to try to put some order into the circumstances of our country. Largely, we saw that in the budget. We've seen a budget that is making a very determined effort to solve some of the structural problems of our economy. Already, we're talking about moving from what? A deficit of some 9% to 6.5%. We're talking about moving the rate of growth of our economy from 3.6% to 6.5%. We're seeing the initiatives that are going to free the private sector and stimulate the private sector to begin to produce again in Ghana. The era of high taxes, excessive taxation, to feed apparently insatiable appetite of the central government is over. We've now seen the a fiscal and economic stance that is about growing the economy of our country. I believe that with this is the background that got me to make these decisions. I'm aware that people are concerned about what they see as maybe the cost of this large government. But there's one or two things that I can say. The number of, for instance, amongst the deputy ministers, 42 out of the 50 are all parliamentarians. And in effect, converting them from parliamentarians into ministers, the marginal cost of that transformation is minimal in terms of its impact on the public exchequer. So, and overall, I believe of the 110 ministers of my government, some 65 to 70% are all from Parliament. So the burden on the public exchequer, which is a matter that is agitating some minds, may not necessarily be as anywhere as acute as people think. When they think, oh, ministers, so already you have a certain image. But in fact, the ministers we're talking about are largely parliamentarians. Let me just finish. And then on top of it, at the end of the day, if our strategy for economic growth succeeds, and in a year, 2 years, 3 years down the road, we are seeing the expansion and the growth of the Ghanaian economy, more jobs are coming onto the market and being taken up by our young people, our agriculture has begun to boom, we have taken already some important initiatives in that area. There's a stimulus package that we put into on the road towards reviving our industrial sector. If these measures succeed in accelerating the rate of growth of our economy and creating greater prosperity, I believe that what you call the brouhaha will turn out to be exactly that, a brouhaha.
But sorry, sir,
over the size of the government.
Coming here, but there's also the fear that by some of your appointments, you appear to be creating a parallel civil service where some of the civil service organizations which are already in existence will become redundant, so to speak.
I don't see it.
Like the Public Procurement Authority, for instance. Now, there is a public procurement minister.
There's a public procurement minister who's going to work from the office of the president, not as the one regulating or implementing the process of public procurement, far from it, but as a minister in my office who is going to have an eagle eye on that process. All of us know the tremendous challenges that the system of public procurement in our country has had in these last 5-6 years. Huge contracts many of them very questionable, sole sourcing. I wanted a minister here, somebody familiar with the process of public procurement, whose duty will be to keep me fully engaged all the time in what is going on, and therefore being able at any one stage to be able to alert me if she sees, because it's a he, it's a she sees that something has gone awry in that system. I think for the purposes of where we are now in Ghana, where we've gone through this traumatic experience over public procurement, it is necessary for us to focus on it as an area of special concern. And that is what the minister is coming to do. The minister is not coming to take over the work of the public procurement authority. On the contrary, I was one of those who fashioned the law. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea of the law was, in fact, to keep the political element out of the process of public procurement. But at the end of the day, the law didn't achieve its purpose. An exception, a limited exception to the way public procurement should normally be run, became the basis for became the norm. I think it is important that I have an instrument that allows me, not oversight over the public procurement, but an insight into what is going on. Somebody who will be chasing and receiving the reports and finding out, both from the ministerial as well as the national central level, what exactly is going on. Because I'm determined, as much as possible, to ensure that competitive bidding and the teachings of the Public Procurement Act are upheld and are met.
In other words, yeah. Mr. President, you want to assure Ghanaians that you still stand by your promise of protecting the public purse, and for that matter, ensuring that the public purse works for the interest of the nation.
Absolutely. And not only we're doing that in terms of ensuring that the public procurement process works like it was originally intended to work, but then there are all the other ancillary measures that I intend to take, that I've begun to take, to make sure that accountability in our political system once again becomes the norm and not the exception. We want a situation where political office holders are the first to recognize that they serve the public interest, not their own personal interests. I've said it time and again. Those of my party and adherents, like-minded people who think that coming into the public sector is going to be an avenue for making money under Akufo-Addo are going to be disappointed, to the extent that my eyes and ears can see what is going to happen. I'm not going to allow that to happen. For instance, as we sit today, in a record time, all the first appointments that I made have all declared their assets. All 36 ministers who are the first lot of appointees that I made have all, as of yesterday, declared and filed their assets with the Auditor General. It is part of a process of reassuring the Ghanaian people that the commitments that we made to protect the public purse, the commitments that we made to ensure that we live with a political system that minimizes corruption, which has really ravaged our country and brought us to this low level of economic decline, that there is going to be a systematic attempt to deal with it. You know, of course, the measures that we have put in place for creating a new office of special prosecutor. As always in these matters, I mean, you hear all kinds of...
Still on the ministerial appointments, you have said that you inherited a debt of 2.4 billion, and then you also inherited...
I said a 2.4 billion debt overhang in the energy sector.
In the energy sector alone.
The energy sector alone.
So the debt is more than 2.4 billion put together.
122 billion.
That's huge.
It's
so
huge.
I'm looking at, again, you mentioned the fact that you also inherited revenue sources that were leaking. Now, having said all these things, and considering the fact that when and I've seen figures being peddled around, that your ministers are going to consume as much as 20 million Ghana cedis every year. Where are we going to get the money from, considering the fact that the purse is leaking?
I'm not quite sure that those figures are even accurate. But the point that I'm trying to make is this. You have a problem. What is the best way of dealing with the problem? My view is that our country is better served by having on board in the executive men and women who are capable of working to reverse the situation. Because for me, the most important thing that I can do for the Ghanaian people, apart from the institutional issues to do with corruption and how we can plug the hole and leakages, is to grow our economy. If we can grow our economy, the investment involved in something like, assuming that your figure is even right, contested, but assuming, will be a little drop in the ocean. And it will be seen as having been a necessary investment to make. People who are coming into government in my time are coming to work. It is not going to be a holiday. We're not going to approve a situation whereby people are ministers and they think that it's a time for larking and merrymaking and having a good time. On the contrary, I'm in this office at 9 o'clock every day. You ask anybody here, and I leave here late at night every day. I'm with, at the behest of much complaining from Lady Rebecca. It's all the time. But that is the reality of my life. And those, the others, if you, any of you may care to go around and find out what they're doing, Chamating and Ofuriate and the others, that same midnight oil burning and working. We are coming to work for the Ghanaian people. The men and women I've assembled are capable, they're strong, they're competent. We have Kwesi Anka dealing with tertiary education, if you can see the contrast. We've got the people who are there poised to do the work. And as I'm saying, if I succeed, and pray God I succeed, you have to wish that I succeed, because my success is not for myself. My success is for the people of Ghana. And if I do succeed, I think you will find that the discussion about the size of the government would have turned out to be really something quite minor. We have something else that we have to remember. I've heard in the public discourse comparisons being made between ourselves and other countries in Europe or Japan or America. I'm always a little bit astonished.
Right. Your Excellency, because of the lack of time, can we move on to the other issues now?
I thought that this was your main issue.
No,
Mr. President, I thought this was your main issue why you came here.
But there are other important issues that I'm sure that Ghanaians would like to hear your views on.
I would want to know when we should expect the independent special prosecutors.
I think much sooner than later. First of all, the policy paper will be we'll have the cabinet at the end of next week. It'll be before the cabinet. Once it's approved, the next session of parliament will receive the legislation. I'm talking about the second meeting. This meeting is coming to an end at the end of next week. But the next meeting that begins on the 15th of May, once we are satisfied with the policy rationale for the establishment of the office, much of that has been worked out. But the Attorney General is finalizing her memorandum to Cabinet. Once that has been approved, we'll take it to Parliament at the earliest opportunity when the Parliament resumes on the 15th of May. Have it passed, and then we will take the steps to actually fill the office and obey whatever teachings the legislation will set up. And it's important. But it's important not just the symbolic thing that a special prosecutor is set up, but that we give it teeth, we give it the opportunity to be able to work properly. And also other matters that need to be brought together in the fight against corruption. I've told you about the assets declaration of my ministers. And also my determination to bring before the parliament soon as possible, hopefully the second meeting again, a bill that seeks to amend the assets declaration. that will allow the parliament to revisit it again, whether or not there should be public disclosure. We're having internal rules that says that once you're appointed, if you're an Article 71 office holder, once you're appointed, within 2 weeks of your appointment, you have to file your return, your declaration, assets declaration with the Auditor General. I mean, there are a series of measures that are being put together. And then, of course, the most critical and the most important, the personal example that myself and those working with me will have to set. That is the best guide to how successful the fight against corruption is going to be.
Exactly. In your State of the Nation address, you made a commitment that the economy will not collapse under your watch. Now, as you prepare to fix those loopholes you would have found in the economy, which are some of the immediate areas that you want to give priority to?
I've said so. I said so a little bit earlier. The most important for me are the measures that we will and have put in place to grow the Ghanaian economy. 3.6% rate of growth means that our people are going to continue to have major challenges. Challenges of employment, access to social services, challenges of access to power. A 3.6 rate of growth, when you have a population growth which is around about 3% itself, means that effectively you're not growing. You're stagnating. And stagnating means that, in fact, you're going backwards. We can't afford that. We need to grow the Ghanaian economy again. And that is why the first budget of my presidency was dedicated to trying to clear the space for the private sector of our country to grow. And like I said, to shift the focus of economic management and policy from tax, to rather leaving as much resources, as much disposable resources as possible in the hands of economic operators, private enterprises, people who have a sense of enterprise, a sense of creativity, are prepared to take risk, so that they can invest in their own enterprises, and if possible, begin also to create new enterprises and new businesses. If we are able to grow the Ghanaian economy, if this analysis of the problems confronting our country, these analysis is correct, and that indeed, if we clear the way for the private sector and provide that support, both fiscal and monetary support for the private sector, we're going to have to do something if you begin to close the deficit. That's our agenda, the deficit that we inherited of 9%, we're closing it to 6.5%. All of those are the measures that allow you to start dealing with interest rates, so that interest rate starts coming down. When they start coming down, once again, you're feeding the private sector the opportunity. People can go and borrow money, which they feel they can pay back, and they have the confidence now to go and begin to expand their businesses, to create new businesses. You allow new people to come into the economic system. So the overall strategy is a strategy about growth. We do not contemplate a situation where we're going to repeat the rates of growth that we have seen in our economy in the last 3 or 4 years. There is no joy in that for the people of Ghana. And we have come, as the Asempa budget says, to bring joy to the Ghanaian people and not more suffering.
Mr. President, can we now move on to the funding of the free SHS?
Yes.
I'm wondering where the funds are going to come from to support
the free HS?
The free HS.
I'm surprised at you. Have you heard the parliament has just passed the bill?
Yes, the
budget?
But just for reiteration, I would be happy if you can.
But you know the parliament has passed the budget.
Yes,
I know. The budget provides for the funding of the free HS system. It's being funded from the budget. I'm more efficient and intelligent.
The questions have also been asked about the sustainability.
I'm saying we made a commitment. We said that we will begin 2017-2018 academic year to fund the free senior high school program. We have begun from within budget resources, a more efficient use of our resources. We have found the money to begin the process. I think if we found the money to begin the processes, you can count on us to find the money to sustain the process. This matter is not, and I've kept saying it, I want to repeat it again, it is not a political gimmick. It goes to the heart of our effort to develop our country. Unfortunately, at this stage in our history, the numbers of people who should have access to education, but because of money cannot, are much more than those who are able to enter the system. And we want to be able to assemble the Ghanaian human capital in all its diversity and multiplicity so that we can really make a good fist about growing our country and setting it on.
I'm sorry if I sound repetitive, but the question still is, where is the money going to come from?
Coming from the budget.
The same budget you refer to, Your Excellency, has reduced taxes on importation of spare parts, on airline tickets, and so on and so forth.
It's coming from the consolidated fund. That's exactly where it's coming from. And the consolidated fund that's going to grow, not shrink, because of the measures we've taken over taxes, the measures that we've taken to remove what is now gone into the political lexicon as the nuisance taxes. What you have to get your mind around is that we are staking the fortunes of our government on the simple principle that if we can provide the stimulus that will allow the private sector to grow, that was the way we can create prosperity, we can create jobs, and we can create higher and higher income levels. That's the analysis that we have made. And that's the perspective in which we're, and that is why we're saying that as much as possible, the monies that are in the hands of economic operators, let the money stay there, let them use it to grow their businesses and grow their economy. Don't let it come to the central government that is going to use it just in many of the ways that we've seen the central government use it. So it is not in terms of removing these taxes that we are therefore crippling our capacity to raise revenue. On the contrary, I remember vividly that in President Kufuor's time, when he first reduced corporate income tax, the revenue he collected from companies went up. Mm. Yeah, because people found it less, they weren't so interested in finding ways to escape taxes.
Sorry, but on the contrary, your budget says that over a period of time, corporate tax will reduce from 25% to 20%.
We're going to do that as well, once again, as a stimulus. Because that's what we want to do. We want to stimulate private sector activity in our country. And we think that when we do that, we'll get a much faster rate of growth than we're doing with all these controls and the mindset, which is about tax, tax, tax. We think that freeing the economy, freeing those who have the capacity to invest, save and invest, they will be those who will be able to raise up our economy and bring prosperity to our nation. Mm. And that's if you like, it's the calculation, the gamble, whatever you want to call it. But that is what it is based on. Don't be frightened about these reductions in tax revenue. I'm sure when I come back to you next year, you'll find that it probably, and with the very, very important efforts that are going to be made by Kufinti and the others who are now in charge of the revenue collecting agencies to plug leakages. We're told that at the ports, $150 million on a monthly basis is the nature of the leakage at the ports. So, I mean, can you imagine what it means just to close that gap? That's what, $1.5 billion a year. These are your little taxes that you're talking about. They don't really represent that. So we are focusing on both ends of the issue. We're focusing on the stimulus, and we're also focusing on a more rigorous attitude towards the public purse and making sure that leakages that we've seen systematically in our system are eliminated. It'll bring about that wash of money into our system that will allow us to finance many of the initiatives that we want to do.
All right.
Mr. President, if I may ask my last question. We are told you are using an old vehicle, in fact, a BMW 2007 model.
Oh, really?
this is what is in the public domain.
I'm not sure. I don't know the year. But it's
I'm wondering, if that is so, why is it so? And then are you aware
that there are
a number of state vehicles missing?
I've been told a committee was set up under the chairmanship of the former Attorney General, Aikwelu, to examine this question. And I believe I have not yet received the report. I've heard through the grapevine, perhaps the same, that they're saying that a certain number of cars were missing. I'm praying that those cars were not stolen from the presidency, because really, it would be too bad if people were to steal from the presidency of Ghana. Then we're not safe at all in this country, in the presidency itself. But I believe that those findings have been made. It'll be in the public domain for all of us. But as far as this car is concerned, this is the car I found here. I found it quite satisfactory. I go up and down it. I'm not particularly fussy about cars myself, so I'm okay with it. Or you want to give me a new one?
Well, so our very final question, Your Excellency, and I would like to thank you once again for having us in your office. Now, you have a 4-year mandate with the possibility of renewing it, but moving forward, what would you want to be remembered for after the 4 years, the first 4 years of your presidency?
Some things are far-reaching, but I think that they're very important. First of all, that it was in under my watch that the Ghanaian economy picked up, and that again we started getting higher rates of growth of our economy that made it possible for the living standards of our people to improve, for employment to become more and more and more available to the young people of our country. That it becomes, if you like, some sort of a golden age in the economic development of our country. It will give me the greatest of satisfaction to know that with the challenges that I inherited, that were on the ground when I came in, and that by virtue of the collaborative work between me and this very, very good team that I put together, that we grew the Ghanaian economy again, and that Ghana became not just a model of democratic accountability on our continent, but also became a beacon of economic progress in Ghana. That would be, for me, the icing on the cake. We're praying to God.
Thank you very much, and that will be it for now. I would like to say thank you for making time to be with us here at the office of the President of the Republic of Ghana, Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo. We've been speaking to him concerning various issues that have come up both in the media and within the public domain for discussions. He's answered some of those questions, and this is where we draw the curtains. Your Excellency, thank you so very much for giving us this privilege of being the first set of journalists to get an interview from you. I've been here with my colleague from the Daily Graphic, Kobi Asma. He's the political desk editor. Mm-hmm. My name is Abdulhai Momin, and Your Excellency, thank you very much. We'll see you again some other time in this very office.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And Kobi, thank you too. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
We are grateful to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.